You're listening to episode 36 of Fresh Floppies.
Yes,
right now.
What's up to our sidekicks and henchfolk out there in the Geek Nation? You're tuning in to Fresh Floppies. You know that because Noel just told you that. We're here to discuss the freshest of floppies. What's a floppy, Noel?
Oh, you mean the book? The comic?
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
I mean, there's so many things that are floppy.
I didn't say flaccid.
Craft. I didn't say. Why did your mind go there? I'm talking about like cheese slices.
Oh, my. Flaccid cheese slices.
Noodles.
Yeah. So comic books.
Yeah. weekly, monthly periodicals that are one chapter of an ongoing story that we enjoy that are called comic books.
Yeah.
We're going to spoiler-free review a bunch of stuff that came out today, December 27th,
yes.
Year of Our Lord 2023, the last week
of
2023.
Yeah. Timeless came out, which is a now annual...
Did it come out today?
Yes.
And...
Yes.
That makes our conversation about it quite timely.
Ah, I hate it.
That was the worst.
The future of the Marvel Universe revealed. Again, Timeless is something that they do once a year. It's a one-shot that comes out. It's like a thickie boy. It's like three issues in one. It's like a big story that kicks
it's like
off.
The third year for it,
yeah.
I think. Yeah.
Yeah.
No
it
numbers.
Kicks off the year. It's number one.
But it's not.
Just call it a one-shot, man. I get so many customers who are like, hey, where's issue two of that thing? And we have to look it up, and we're like, it's
but
a one-shot.
I should put the year, though. How about that? Like,
yeah,
Timeless 2023.
Perfect. Nailed it. Hmm. Or 2024, since that's what it's leading into. I don't know. And this is the future of, this is literally the future of the Marvel Universe. Well, a future. And we've got Luke Cage.
Well, hang on, who's it written by? Who's the creative team?
Right.
What the hell's
it's
wrong with
Kelly
you?
And Lansing.
Writers Jackson Lansing and Colin Kelly with art by
Juan
Cabal, who I actually really like Juan Cabal. He did Guardians with Al Ewing.
It reminds me a little bit of Dauterman.
There's a little bit of Dauterman.
A little bit of Dauterman.
There's a couple of flashback sequences that are like there's a little bit of Javier Rodriguez.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
You mean from the History of the Marvel Universe?
Yeah. The History of the Marvel Universe written by Mark Waid. It's available in Treasury as well as paperback edition with multiple covers. Everyone should get it.
So we're not going to spoil this, but you give them the elevator pitch.
We are an indeterminate amount of time into the future of the Marvel Universe. Luke Cage is old man Luke Cage,
mm-hmm.
just so happens to also be imbued with the power of all the living weapons,
yeah.
including the Hulk. At this point, we don't know how, we don't know why, and he is stopping people from sacrificing themselves to the moon. And we learn that Khonshu has finally, like, I don't know, final form Khonshu.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, yeah.
And the immortal Moon Knights are convincing people to sacrifice themselves,
yeah.
off themselves for energy so Khonshu can go full celestial. And Luke Cage's last-ditch effort to stop him. Now, what's kind of cool about this and like, hey, why does this matter for the rest of the line of comics? One, I don't really know. But also in the context of the story, there are times when Luke Cage, because he's so, like, I guess, in tune with so many mystical things, feels timeline shifting. And then you start to see almost like a shattered version of teases of stories to come.
Yes.
So it's one part solid one-shot narrative of... Luke Cage fighting Moon Knight, who may not be who you think he is.
Yeah.
They are. Who may not be who you think they are. Could be she. Don't know. Could be they. Could be alien. Who knows?
Yep.
And
could be a bunch of squirrels
in a
trench coat.
It could be a swarm of bees.
Yeah. Oh, that's an actual character. Yeah, hive. No.
Swarm.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, but no spoilers. yeah, and you get these like really cool... shatters or hints, and the way that it ends feels like, oh, well, maybe this isn't just a one-shot story. Maybe we'll see these characters again.
Yeah.
And you know what? I kind of liked this version of the character. I think he's kind of cool. Old man Luke is cool.
I mean, Luke himself is pretty cool.
Yeah.
Old man Luke is cooler.
Yeah.
The one problem I had is that we don't see a certain character that he knows. that I was surprised.
He talks about them.
Does he?
Yeah.
Oh, great. I missed it. I'm a dummy.
It's quick stuff. There's a lot of backstory. Yeah. No. Doesn't talk about that at
all. That's what I'm talking about. Yeah.
Maybe there's more story to tell.
I hope so.
A timeless story to tell that will come out timely. So we were talking off mic. We were talking about this is the third timeless story.
Yeah.
And it was like, hey, they tease a bunch of stuff that never happens or nothing happens. Last year's Timeless was written by Jed McKay, and just the last 6 months, they've been introducing a lot of those things teased in his Avengers run. Okay. So if you're not reading Avengers, it's really fun. Everyone should read it. What did you think of this art?
The arc?
The art.
Oh, the art. Yeah, the Daughterman light. I think it's fine. It does not make me excited. You know, I think it's very by the numbers sort of house style kind of work, right? It's just you sit at your desk and you pump out the book.
Yeah.
I don't see any splash pages or anything where I go, oh, I got to take a picture of that. Like with Daniel Warren Johnson, for instance.
Oh, well, no. That's,
yeah, I mean.
That's like the difference between a Porsche and a really good Volvo.
This is like, a guy whose name I don't usually remember. Mm. But he shows up and I go, oh, right, that guy.
Juan Cabal is up there with, like, for me, like with Martin Coccolo or just like the guys that are just putting in solid work on random issues of something. Like when Nick Klein is between arcs, you'll see Juan Cabal do a fill-in issue.
Yeah.
And it doesn't mess with the momentum of the book. It's just kind of solid. And like this is one of those artists that's probably like one Cracker Jack title away from being like a Stormbreaker. What do they call
it? Stormbreakers. Yeah. That's it.
Did you notice that in the splash page, this here?
Mm-hmm.
Dario Agger.
Oh, is that who that is?
Yeah.
From Thor.
Yeah, so...
from the Mighty Thor.
I don't feel super bad about this spoiler because it's like 4 issues ago in Thor.
Oh, okay.
Dario Agger, the Roxxon Corporation, like the weird centaur monster.
Yeah.
In the Thor book, which everyone should read because it's kind of fun.
The Immortal Thor.
Immortal Thor. Purchases the rights of Thor in comics to own the stories and how the like he wants to own the myth of Thor and thus taking away his like kind of power.
What?
Yeah, it's wild. So he actually bought Journey into Mystery number four, blah, blah,
and that's and, why he's reading.
Yeah, think about it's like if Disney purchased up all of Marvel, it's the Roxxon Corporation is purchasing all of the stories of some of these characters.
That's pretty interesting. Yeah.
So, like, cool. One of the splash pages is him holding, like, a fictional character holding a comic book that came out.
I was wondering what that was. Yeah,
that's cool. A cool book, too. You should catch up on that.
But, yeah, this is a great one-shot.
I'd say fresh enough.
Yeah.
It's like, sometimes one-shots are aggressively poor.
Mid.
This is fun.
Yeah. Duke, number one, which is part of the, I almost said Massiverse, the Energon universe, which is a shared universe from Image Comics that pieces together Transformers, G.I. Joe, as well as Robert Kirkman's series Void Rivals. And this is the first issue of the G.I. Joe adjacent series.
Yeah, it seems as though
it's not called G.I. Joe.
They're
just Duke.
Building it, maybe?
Yeah.
So it's Duke and then...
Cobra Commander.
In 2 weeks, Cobra Commander comes out?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
But this isn't the first time we met Duke in this universe.
Nope.
If you recall... I almost got into the...
Last time.
I'm sorry, the reindeer. The most famous reindeer of all.
Rudolph?
Yeah, because we just watched that with my son for the first time. Anyway.
How do you like it?
If you recall.
No, let's stay on this
thread. Oh, he ignored it. He
ignored it?
Yeah,
oh.
He didn't care. I spent $7.99 for that movie, and he did not care. but, yeah, if you recall, Duke was in Transformers.
Yep.
And so this is actually dealing directly with the fallout from his interaction with a Transformer in Transformers number 2 or 3, I think 2, and what it has done to him. This was awesome.
I'm just shaking my head.
I loved this. What did you think? Oh, Joshua Williamson, Tom Riley, one of my new favorite artists, Tom Riley.
That's what I thought of it. So Joshua Williamson, I'm usually hit or miss, but he's typically, at best, he's typically very solid.
Yeah.
But his words are nothing. Tom Riley owns this book.
Yeah.
Tom Riley is this book. Tom Riley, I think he can't do anything wrong.
He's
like
killing
this
it.
Book is
so good.
The aesthetic of this book is not the same aesthetic as G.I. Joe Real American Hero.
No.
Right?
No.
But it still feels like it belongs there. Like there is a pastiche. There's like a 1960s pastiche kind of feel to it, but still very modern.
Yep.
His layouts are rad. The acting I really, really like. Like seeing Conrad Hauser, a.k.a. Duke, go from the first page splash to him with like long hair and kind of grody.
Yeah.
Looks the same, but different. Like there's really good characterization in this book, and yeah, I really, really dug it a lot. This was awesome. Awesome.
And I love the way it's setting up the whole universe. We've got, not AIM, what are they called? Mars. The Mars Corporation, which eventually will introduce Destro, of course, as we all know. We kind of see him.
It's just...
And him going to a meeting about...
Aliens,
and what are they called?
UFOs?
Conspiracy theories have you, because... Even though we saw the giant thing happen with, was it Jetstorm or?
Jetstorm or Starscream.
Starscream, whatever. Yeah. We saw it happen. The world doesn't know. Mm-hmm. Somehow they're hiding the fact that there's giant robots.
Yeah.
And so everyone thinks that he's nuts.
Yeah, and there are some classic character names you'll see in here, but the roles that they play aren't necessarily ally at first. This was fun.
Yeah,
this was a really fun like year one. It's Duke year one, my dude.
Oh, it is. Yeah, it is. Yeah.
This is really fun. I liked it. I liked it more than I thought.
This was fresh AF. For
me. This was fresh.
I love this book.
And then we got a couple of intros for some new guys. Yeah, I'm happy. And it seems as though how they're structuring this is really fun too. You got a 5-issue mini of Duke, a 5-issue mini of Cobra Commander, and hopefully at the end of it, it'll just coalesce into a G.I. Joe book. Yeah. But yeah, no, I liked this a lot. I think we should talk about what's happening in the light of the dawn of DC.
Yes.
Cresting over the mountains in that light.
Uh-huh.
Titans.
Yeah. The Titans corner of the DC.
The Titans corner of the DC universe. The Tom Taylor corner of the DC universe.
Yeah, man.
Which one do you want to talk about first? Titans? Well, you know what? Let's do Beast World first, because when I was reading Titans, it said, takes place after the events of Titans.
That's true.
Beast World 3
goes first, in case you haven't read them yet. On your stack, it goes Titans, Beast World number 3, and then you can read Titans number 6.
This is written by Tom Taylor with art by Lucas Meyer. Hang on.
It's fine. It's great. It's great. It's great.
It's good art.
It's just not Yvonne Reese.
So I got, before I read this, I got a text from JD. That's how I read it.
Yeah, that's how I typed it.
Issue 3 is not drawn by Yvonne Reese. And I was like, oh no. So I picked it up right away. And I flipped through it, and objectively, I was like, it's actually pretty slick art. It's very good.
It looks great. But it's not like Yvonne Reese.
It's not like they got just like stable guy.
Yeah.
Even though I've never heard of Lucas Meyer.
I don't know who this is.
This is strong.
Yeah.
I it didn't feel like a skidding breaks.
No, not at all.
Of the story. So I was actually okay with it. You know what would have happened if you hadn't texted me that? I'd get 5 pages in and be like, this doesn't really look like I mean, it's fine. Like, it wouldn't have stopped me. Mm-hmm. Whereas other switch-ups of artists, I would open the first page and be like, what the fuck is this?
Why have you done this to me?
And then I'd throw it across the room, and it wouldn't have been enough, so I would also set it on fire.
What did you think of the issue, though?
I thought the issue was solid.
Yeah.
I am not super in love with this event.
Oh, no, I'm enjoying it.
I'm enjoying it.
Yeah.
But I'm not sure why it's not just an arc of Titans yet.
Oh, sure.
It's not even though they're telling me the stakes are huge and all this stuff is happening across the world, I still only really care about Garfield for Beast Boy, and it's a Titans book. Like, it really does just feel like the next issue of Titans. It doesn't feel like an event. So I think the dissonance with me is that. Like, is this an event? It's just a Titan miniseries.
Yeah.
Or it's the next arc of Titans. And reading we're going to talk about it next, reading the next issue of Titans almost felt like filler because this is the next issue of Titans.
Oh. I guess.
It's good, but it's just also
You don't think it's big enough?
The event?
Yeah.
Doesn't feel it.
Okay.
Doesn't feel it. And maybe...
To me, it feels bigger. This feels bigger to me than Night Terrors did.
Yes, it feels bigger than Night Terrors, but it doesn't feel bigger than Dark Crisis.
Oh, no. No.
So this would be like...
I don't think every event has to be a crisis.
I think they all have to... No. Not a crisis, but it still has to feel like insurmountable and as large as the world. And in this, it just feels like they're telling me that, and I don't really like feel it across other books.
Gotcha.
I don't disagree with you, but it's not something that occurred to me. I was too busy going, oh, man, this is way better than I thought it was going to be. Because I saw this coming, and I went, I like Tom Taylor, but I don't care about these events that DC's been doing lately. I didn't care about Dark Crisis once it was over. I didn't care about Night Terrors. And I was like, oh, Beast World, great. A Beast Boy event. I don't care. I like the Titans. I love the Teen Titans. Yeah. They're my dudes. Gar is not one of them. I never am like, oh my God, I wonder what's going to happen to Gar. You know. So the fact that it was a Beast Boy event wasn't excited. I am all in. I'm really enjoying it. Now, I have not read the ancillary one-shots.
Like I read one of them.
World Tour Metropolis, etc.
I read one of them. I read two of them. It was enough for me.
Yeah. I didn't even... I don't care enough.
So I think my problem is coming from... I've been reading Titans since Jump.
Mm-hmm.
And then Titans, the book, set up the big bad that kicks this off.
Mm-hmm.
So it just... They seamlessly rolled into each other.
Yeah.
The Necro Star from the... Like, it was all a Titans thing, and then it just rolled into this. And this is the same consistent tone.
Mm-hmm.
So it just feels like more Titans. And yeah. I'm loving it, but yeah. Even I'm trying to think of like a current or a recent comparison. Even Devil's Reign, even though as small as that event was, still felt more like an event than this does.
Really?
Yeah. Oh. And I think it's just I don't know what it is.
Okay.
I don't know what's doing it to me. It, like and I don't know what the solution is. Like we do it one way where it's like we're going to stop all the books and just like
nope.
No, hang on. If you do it that way, I'm not happy. This way where it's like minimal footprint,
yeah,
still doesn't feel like very big. I don't know.
It doesn't bother me. I'm in.
It doesn't
like
bother
it.
Me. It just doesn't feel like an event.
That's fair.
Yeah.
I am enjoying it as a Titan story. I'm glad that the Titans have a good book currently.
Oh yeah.
And this has been forever. A bucket of fun, and I like what Tom Taylor is doing with Gar and how we got to the point that we're at here with Beast World. Very clever.
Now, what I think is super super amazing about this is in Titans they set up that when Gar goes big and small, it does affect him no matter what. He could be a swarm of bees. When those bees get hurt,
he feels it.
Yeah. That still lives in my head rent free. So every time one of these little Staros spores gets killed, I'm like,
what's going up? What's happening to Garth? Or Gar? Yeah.
Yeah, that pisses me off. Yeah. Garth and Gar.
Yeah.
Beast Boy. What's going to happen to Beast Boy? That's staying in my head. And I love the fact that Tom Taylor did that, and I hate him for it.
it's an interesting element to bring to the character, for sure.
Mm-hmm.
Do you want to talk about Titans as well?
Yeah, let's talk about Titans
number six.
Yeah, this was spoilers for three issues ago, the reveal of this Necro Star, this big like evil
Eternity.
Starro.
What's his name? Brother Eternity.
Yeah, Brother Eternity.
Used to be Brother Blood. Now he's Brother Eternity.
You find out he's Tamarin, and then it becomes kind of
Tamarinian.
Like Tamarinian.
Yeah, he is of Starfire's lineage.
Tamarin is the planet. Tamarinian.
Yeah, Tamarinian is a person.
So it just becomes like a Starfire side story, one shot that kind of bleeds in.
Which I think is even cooler because you think it's a Beast Boy event, and now it's also a Starfire event, right?
And they do something at the end of this issue that I'm like, no. Oh, you're going to flip and see what it is? Not in like a don't do that kind of way, in like a wait, what?
Uh-oh. Oh, yes.
Yeah. It was like and that it didn't happen in the main book. This has a...
Yeah.
This No, that's not necessarily a negative thing.
Well, I mean, I think it agrees with what you were saying earlier about the
It does. It's just like they're the same book. It's just like
also,
shots.
Also, did you notice there's a thing happening in Beast World 3 and Titans 6?
Hi, buddy boy.
And they seem to not match each other? Because
her outfit,
she's having it out with Black Adam, and Black Adam runs away.
Oh,
and then in Titan 6, which happens afterwards, she's still fighting Black Adam, and then other people have to show up to fight Black Adam.
Oh, I think it's this is weird. Yes and no. So linearly doesn't work. If the events of the scene we see in Titans actually happens before. And then after the scene we see where he runs off in Beast World, it kind of works. Because they do go help her.
Okay.
And then we see in Beast World, he runs off.
Yeah.
And then in Titans, just the next scene is her getting back to the tower.
Gotcha.
It's like in between, I guess.
Yeah.
It's not a...
Thought a little goofy.
Yeah.
Go. Go. Well, do you...
Go.
You're enjoying it, though.
Oh, like it. Oh, no, it's fresh.
It's like, fresh.
These are... We just spent 5 minutes minor griping.
Yes.
This is a good book. This is fun comics.
Agreed. Yeah. You know what else is fun comics?
I think you're going to say Sensational She-Hulk because it's one of the best ongoing comics that Marvel is putting out right now.
It really is. However, as I'm reading this, She-Hulk Sensational number 3 by Rainbow Rowell and Andre
Genolet.
While it's delightful, and I read 3 issues straight through.
Like water.
Yeah, yep. I was thinking of the gentleman who was a retailer and he was upset about modern comics.
Yeah.
And a lot of folks who I think they think this is a bad book because there isn't enough punching in it.
Mm.
But and there isn't a lot of punching in it.
No.
But I am laughing out loud several times. I am engaged and enamored with the character beats that are happening.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's really well crafted and really well done. This is not a punch 'em up comic book, and I think many people might think that a She-Hulk book should be.
I think a lot of but I think those people, the people that think that this should be a solid punch 'em up comic, mm-hmm. have never read She-Hulk long term.
Right.
Because it's always been a little bit more of a relationship drama mm-hmm. and a slight legal drama, but yep. more of a comedic off-center book.
Yeah.
It's always been a, like, yeah. even when John Byrne was doing it with
oh, for sure.
the high
especially
level,
when he was
the high level of cheesecake and punch-em-ups, there was mm-hmm. also a lot of, there's a subversive energy to this book that should always be there.
Yeah.
And this is the same thing. Also, those people may not either claim or be aware of the history of comics and how they started as fucking romance books yeah. and cowboy books and comedy books. Mm-hmm. This is not a superhero book, but mm-hmm. it just features superheroes.
But all of the interesting stuff, I had to skip because, oh, okay. Uh-oh. I also have to talk about, I hate that they stopped with issue 15.
Yeah.
And then just renumbered it with a number 1.
Yeah.
And it is number 16, 17, and 18. These are the yeah. issues we're reading, but they're calling them 1, 2, and 3. That drives me absolutely nuts. And they even tell us why. In the back of issue 1, they go, we wanted to get this book into more hands, and the fact is more people buy a number 1 than they buy a number 16.
Mm-hmm.
I get it. But at least make a reason for it. At least have it feel like a number 1, not a number 16. Like
there
this
was a... I'll defend it a little bit, because at the end of the last run, just She-Hulk,
yeah.
There was a pretty good big bad and triumphant moment. Mm-hmm. And it did feel kind of like I could ramp off. Mm-hmm. And at the beginning of this, they recapped it and you could ramp on. So at least it wasn't wholly jarring or inorganic. It was just, but yes, it...
And she's dealing with the same characters
she's dealing
that
with
she
same,
was
but they're
from
introduced,
the first arc of the first series.
The way that they're introduced in issue 3 is the same way that randos are introduced in any superhero comic. Because they do give you like the little names and the little this. And
yeah.
hey, that time that you like.
Oh, I mean, everything
still,
is explained.
Still good.
Yeah, everything explains. I'm just saying the way you don't think Titans Beast World feels mm-hmm. like an event, this doesn't feel like issues 1, 2, and 3 of a series. It feels like 16, 17, 18. I just wish they introduced a brand new plot
Maybe.
And not are just rehashing
oh,
the
I,
stuff.
So I also do
or
kind
not
of disagree
I'm sorry, not rehashing.
It's a new
continuing.
Plot. It's just the continuation. Yeah.
What's the new plot?
I mean, all of the Fox stuff is completely taken care of. The she was becoming attracted to this
right. The other guy, the thief.
Like,
the French thief.
Was wrapped up. That was a nice little yeah. plot on, and you just enter this book with. She's working at Mallory Book's law firm. It's not it's not impenetrable. It's not also like I hear your gripe.
Yeah.
But I have a feeling it's a gripe not unlike the one that I had for Titans. It's a gripe specifically for people that know enough like us.
Okay.
Do you know what I mean? Like
sure.
if you had somebody come to me like, I really want to start She-Hulk, you can give them these 1, 2, and 3. And if they like it, because the tone I do think is incredibly accessible.
Oh, yeah.
If they like it, then you also walk over to your shelf where you have 3 copies of Just Jen, which is the first volume, and we go from there. Like,
see, I would start them with Just Jen. I'd be like, you can jump in here, but I'd really recommend you jumping in here with the trade paperback.
Between you potentially having somebody monthly, ongoing, and then also a sale to just a one-off.
Yeah, maybe. All that being said, that is a marketing gripe.
Oh, yeah.
That is a editorial gripe.
Yeah, you hear that, Mark Miller?
Rainbow Rowell is killing it. I love this book so much.
Oh, I think we can agree that no matter how you start this book, you just need to start it.
It's great.
Because it's a wonderful book. This is... If I had to bring my pull list down to 5 monthly books, this is going to be one of the 5.
Yeah, it's so good.
Yeah.
I'm glad that you made us do this for this episode so that I could catch up.
Yeah, this is such a good book.
I love it.
I want you to talk about something that I didn't read.
I'm going
to
talk about Green Arrow number 7. I have the... Santa variant.
It's basically
Green Arrow, Green Lantern redo, but it's Green Arrow and Santa. It's adorable.
Wait, is that like the drug one?
No, the drug one's my ward's a junkie. This is a riff on the cover where Green Arrow is shooting the arrow and breaking the lantern that Green Lantern is holding.
Oh, it's Santa's bag. Santa's sack.
Yeah.
We're going to call it a sack.
Listen, y'all, I read issues 1, 2, and 3 of Green Arrow. I did not read 4, 5, and 6. I thought they were great. This is even better.
Oh, yeah?
If you haven't read 1 through 6 of Green Arrow, this is literally a number one that you could... This feels more like a number one than Sensational She-Hulk 1 does. Yeah. This feels like he's finally home, because he's been gallivanting around in time and space, as one does. Wow. And he's finally home, and he's checking in with all of his loved ones and his friends, and being like, oh, wait a minute. The Justice League isn't around, guys? What's up? Hey, anyone? Anyone? So it's like him chatting with the entire Justice League, being like, what happened? I wasn't gone that long. This doesn't feel right. This is a excellent jumping on point for Green Arrow. Highly recommend this. The only problem is, on the cover, they do not get me excited by letting me know that Carmine DiGiacomo is actually the penciler on this. His name isn't on the cover, and he's awesome.
This is 6 issues in, and there's been like 5 pencilers on this book.
Well, I know it's a lot of Azoxy. He did a bunch of it.
Phil Hester was like on and off this book. Like,
maybe that's why I didn't read
for a miniseries. It's got a shit ton of pencilers.
Yeah.
So to relitigate the conversation we just had 2 minutes ago, wouldn't you have preferred this being a number one, like the second miniseries?
Yes.
Yeah.
Yeah. But I don't know if you remember.
Even though chronologically, maybe it's better to understand that he's been shot around timeline for 6 issues, but also that doesn't matter.
Yeah. This would have been a great number one, whereas She-Hulk should have kept its numbering.
How dare you?
And I remember telling somebody, I was like, hey guys, just so you know, Green Arrow is going to be renumbering with a number one soon, because I saw an ad for this issue, and whoever did the lettering on it made the number 7 look like a number 1. So I thought it was going to be a number 1.
If everyone at Marvel is listening to this, because I know you are.
Or DC.
Just at Marvel.
Oh, Marvel?
This is a Marvel message. If to keep She-Hulk on the stands, it requires you to renumber it every month.
Make every issue number 1.
Do it. I don't care. Use every adjective available to put in front of She-Hulk.
Yeah.
Every month I will pick up The Scandalous She-Hulk.
Number 1.
The Super She-Hulk.
Number 1.
The Amazing
Web,
She-Hulk.
Web of She-Hulk. Yeah.
She-Hulk Boy. Superior She-Hulk. I will... Actually, She-Hulk Boy is probably too woke.
Yeah,
and
for
everyone
sure.
will freak out. But then it'll be a sales spike. Let's go.
This is... She-Hulk is great. Anyway, so is Green Arrow. This 7th issue of Green Arrow is a great first issue. Highly recommend. No, you got to
crack myself up. Yeah, I read the first 2 or 3 issues of this series, and I didn't love it as much as you did, but I did find it charming.
Yeah.
So this was always in the back of my head of like, I'm gonna pick up that trade someday. But you tell like it was so popular that they extended the mini to a 12-issue. This is cool. That's why it probably feels like a new number one.
Because it was the end of a story and a
it
start
was the
of a
end
new
of it,
story.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah. It was only meant to be 6, and if they did well, they'd keep going.
I did not know that.
Yeah.
Okay, that makes sense. Aces, what do you got? You tell me about something I didn't read.
I want to talk about something that is not accessible at all if you jumped on now.
Great.
And that's Dawn of DC.
All of it.
: The Penguin, #5, with written by Tom King. Unknown writer. Never heard of him.
Yeah,
Tom King. Yeah. With art by Rafael de la Torre.
Sure.
Yeah, Rafael de la Torre. Fifth issue. So this is the end of the... I think this is the end of the first arc.
This is an ongoing, isn't it?
It's an ongoing.
That's so weird.
Now, it's an ongoing, but for all I know, it's really only going to be 12 issues. Like, that doesn't mean anything these days.
It's true.
But, so this is the end of the first arc, I believe, if you count the backup stories that were in Chip Zdarsky's run that kind of got this going. Where,
right, the issue zero.
Yeah, the issue zero. This book is so interesting.
Oh.
Like... The Wire level of interesting, but in a superhero laden Gotham.
Wow.
So the pitch of the book is that the Penguin, Oswald Cobblepot, he gave up his everything, faked his death, was living as, like, got plastic surgery, was living in Bloodhaven, running a floral shop.
He had a girlfriend, or a wife?
A live-in girlfriend, just an old man living a little old man life, right? Someone from the FBI, CIA, a three-letter agency, finds him and
puts
him to work. Like, I want you to reinsert yourself into the Gotham crime world, and you're going to work for me, period. And the whole four issues after that has been him methodically building his team and his plan. The thing that makes this book really cool, and that's the Wire aspect of it. It's like, it's very detailed, very specific, and very kind of like you're watching like a Machiavellian character kind of put the pieces on the board.
Yeah.
But the perspective of the book shifts from scene to scene. The text boxes, the narration is whatever character's in front of you, and it shifts from scene to scene. So you're reading a story from the perspective of like his hired help, and then the very next scene is what's going on in his head. Like, it keeps jumping back and forth, and you're getting slowly almost like little dots that will become a picture. You're getting pieces of the story from other perspectives in real time, and it's just wild.
That's cool.
It's a challenging read, but it's an incredibly rewarding read.
Awesome.
I love this book.
I read issue one, and I was in. I was very excited.
It just gets better and better. And it's bringing up... Tom King is... I mean, we all know... We're a fan of him here, so that's irrelevant. But he is an old-school comic book fan, and he loves grabbing little things from the past or even from his own other books to just, like, play with them in different ways. So... What was it? 2 years ago, he had that Batman Killing Time miniseries?
Yeah, I never finished that. Shit.
It was great. This... pulls like three characters from that.
This is a direct sequel, right? Didn't we discuss this with issue one? We were like, this is a sequel to Killing Time.
It's an indirect sequel. Yeah. It's got some characters that hold over from it.
Okay.
Because this takes place like 15 years after that one took place. Because that book was like the beginning of Batman's career.
Yeah.
But yeah, like this, this book should, when it comes out in trade, I think the collection is going to come out like in the next couple of months. I will probably push this on a lot of people. Just crime noir, Batman side stuff, especially with the new Penguin show coming out. This is awesome.
Right, I forgot
this is
about
a great
that.
Ass book. I'm very happy with this book. Super fresh.
All right. We did it.
We did
A little late.
We did something.
A little late. It was supposed to be this morning. Sorry, guys. Hopefully we'll get it out today, Wednesday. If not, it'll be Thursday.
Yeah,
and you'll just listen to it then. That'll be great.
Listen to it tomorrow morning. It'll be great.
We'll do it tomorrow. All right. Never mind.
Well, no. I mean, like, if you wake up tomorrow and you're like, oh, it's in there. Listen to it. Yeah. Good thing I'm picking up my books on Thursday.
Well, thanks so much for hanging out with us.
And we'll talk to you later.
Do do do.
Thank you for listening to the Cult Pop Network, home to podcasts, live shows, and a whole lot of fun stuff for every flavor of fan. Follow us wherever you find your favorite podcasts, and be sure to join us live every Wednesday night at youtube.com/cultpopgo at 8 p.m. Eastern. While you're there, be sure to subscribe to the channel and hit the bell icon so you'll know when we drop new Thunder Rounds and episodes of Fresh Floppies, a spoiler-free show about single-issue comics released each week. Until then, we'll talk at you later.